Hi there, I'm Andrew Brown. Welcome to the series Real-Time Music and Sound with Pure Data. In this episode, we're going to be looking at frequency modulation. This diagram shows the basic algorithm for frequency modulation. Like all modulating processes, we have a carrier oscillator and a modulator oscillator, the source of modulation. So the carrier oscillator, like all oscillators, will have a frequency and an amplitude. You can see that the frequency inlet is being dictated to by this modulation, by the output of this modulation oscillator. But not directly. You can see that we're adding that output from the modulation oscillator to a carrier, base carrier frequency. The reason we're doing that is so that this carrier frequency changes to be just above what the bass is and just below what the bass is. It goes up and down, of course, because the modulating oscillator is a bipolar oscillator. It goes from zero up to positive one and then down through to negative one and so forth. So as it goes above and below zero, it will increase and decrease this carrier frequency oscillation. So let's do the patch. We start, as you would expect, with an oscillator, and that oscillator can be connected to a volume control. I can use a number box to specify the amount of volume between 0 and 1, and give it a label. We'll put it on the other side, the right hand side, and then that can be sent out to the digital to analog converter as an output. Same signal go to both sides. So this oscillator is a carrier oscillator. We might label these so that we don't get too confused. In the put menu for PD, where we can create all sorts of boxes on our screen, one of those is the comment box. So we can grab a comment box, put it here, and it's just a bit of text that just can be positioned anywhere, but we can use it to tell us that, remind us that this is the carrier oscillator. Now, that carrier oscillator needs frequency input, but if you recall on the algorithm diagram, above this oscillator, there was a plus object. It's a plus tilde object because we're working with audio signals, and it took in the frequency, the base carrier frequency. So let's give that a title as well. It's the carrier frequency. Can go from zero up to whatever, some bigger number. All right, so this in a sense will provide us with most things we need for the carrier oscillator. Now we need to send it some data. What's going on there? Send it some data from a... Some data from a modulating oscillator. So let's create that modulating oscillator. It also needs to be able to have a frequency specified. We'll want to be able to control the volume of that modulating oscillator, so we can change how much effect it has. Give that a name. It's going to be modulation amplitude. And I think that should be pretty much all. I can go in there. All right, let's see if we get anything. Turn the volume up just a little bit. Specify our bass frequency. There it is, carrier frequency. And now we specify the modulating frequency. I'm going to keep that as a low frequency for a start. Turn up the amount, actually it needs to go up a reasonable amount. And there we can hear we're getting the classic vibrato effect that we would expect as we modulate the frequency of this carrier. So that frequency is going up and down, above and below this bass frequency. So we change the bass frequency, we get a similar amount. It's going up and down in this case by 12. We can increase that so that it increases the amount of vibrato. Okay, so we are modulating the frequency as we go. Now, frequency modulation is also quite well known as a synthesis method. You may or may not know the bit of synthesizer history, but in the 1980s, Yamaha famously released the DX7, which was a very popular synthesizer at the time, which featured frequency modulation synthesis. Frequency modulation is a very efficient synthesis method. As you can see, we just need a couple of sine wave oscillators. In the case of the DX7, it used six of these, so it was a little bit more complicated than what we're doing here, but nevertheless, we're doing the similar principles. So what is the major difference when we're using this as a synthesis process? The major thing which changes is instead of this modulating oscillator being a low frequency oscillator, in this case just operating at 1.2 hertz, we push this modulating oscillator up into the audio spectra. So let's do that now. We increase the frequency. You can hear it's getting faster and faster until eventually we can't hear the individual increases and decreases, but we get this rich spectra appearing. We can also, again, as per before, change the modulation amount. I'm just going to specify some boundaries for that so that I can easily get back to zero. So when this modulation amount is at zero, so there's no modulation, we don't see any change in the waveform. And you can see on the spectrum that we've just got our peak for this carrier frequency. We can move that around. This is our peak. As we increase the amount of modulation, you'll notice that the number of harmonics increases as a result, and that's of course what gives us the rich timbre. And as we make more and more modulation, we get more and more overtones appearing above and below this carrier frequency. The spacing of those overtones is determined by the frequency of the modulator. As you can see, they can get closer or further apart, and that of course changes the timbre that we hear. Let's turn that up slightly so we can hear it. That's changing the modulation frequency. If we change the modulation amplitude, we get richer or less rich overtones being generated. And this is the basis for frequency modulation synthesis. So we have the basics here. Let's make it just a little bit more interesting. One of the things which is often done in frequency modulation synthesis is to make sure that we pay attention to the ratio between the carrier frequency and the modulation frequency, because that determines the kind of spectral patterns that we get. So if we create a slider for the frequency of the carrier, let's say we go from 50 hertz at the lowest up to, I don't know, for the moment, let's just keep it reasonably low, up to 2000 hertz. So this is the carrier frequency. Okay, so we'll leave it up here. make a connection from there to the carrier frequency. So as we change that, we can see that changing. In order to control the modulating frequency relative to this, we'll do some fairly simple math. So we will multiply the carrier frequency by some value. And that value in here will be the ratio between the carrier frequency and the modulating frequency. I can connect that over to there. So, excuse me. There we go. So if I set this to be, say, somewhere around 0.5, then it means that the carrier frequency, when it goes up to 450 odd, is going to be half of that for the modulation. So this is the ratio between the carrier. And let's have a listen to that. When we get a ratio which is reasonably simple, like half is, then we'll get a fairly tonal or harmonic kind of tone. And you can hear that that timbre is maintained across the frequency range. And if we change this ratio now, let's make it something a little less straightforward. Too from before that if we increase our modulation amount, we get richer tones. So if we move this up, let's say close to 1, again we get a really relatively harmonious kind of overtone series. It's a little bit of beating because I'm not quite on 1. And if we get something as straightforward, 1.8 to 1, we get a richer, more set of harmonics, overtones. So let's just keep doing that. So one of the things with FM is you can pretty easily get these kind of rich spectra of overtones. Let's have a look now at what's happening with our amplitude, because even though we can hear the timbre, sometimes the amplitude makes a big difference to what's going on. This particular timbre is quite a rich spectra, and I think we'll find if we add an amplitude to it that it'll sound a little bit like a bell kind of sound. So let's try and do that. We will create our amplitude by using a V-line into there. We can still have a simple number box with the V-line, so that still works just as it did before. However, we can also pass a message to the V-line using a message box, which gives us a ramp. So we might say, let's start at 0. We want to go to maximum volume very quickly over 10 milliseconds and start that immediately. Then we want to ramp back down to 0. Let's say we take 1,000 milliseconds, 1 second to do that, and we'll delay that downward ramp by 10 milliseconds to allow the upward ramp to go. So now, if we click on this message, you can hear that it's starting to sound not unlike a kind of bell tone. We can mess slightly with the fundamental frequency. And so in that way, we can create some quite rich spectra with just a couple of sine wave oscillators. And so frequency modulation can be quite an efficient process for doing some rich timbral spectra. I'll see you in the next video.